Thank you very much. My name is Michael Cejnar. I'm the founding CEO of edQuire. My background is in cardiology and medical device engineering, and which is of course very evidence-based, and also interestingly, like Simon said, very heavy on usability and human factors, because it's of course found that most medical mishaps in hospitals by far are caused by human error and human misuse of the devices. So when my two daughters started using the one-to-one laptop after the DER, I was naturally interested to see what kind of evidence underpins the use of these one-to-one laptops and how effective they our investment of $2.4 billion in Australia has been in this. I looked at the literature and I found not too many studies of efficacy of that, but one of the best was by Simon Crook, who's a physics PhD at Sydney Uni. He did about four or five papers looking at 14 Catholic schools, and he used questionnaires to ask students and teachers how the laptops were being used in STEM classes. And he divided up the uses into quite useful categories of word processing, spreadsheets, and so on, and found, not surprisingly, that the vast majority of use was to replace pen and paper. And he also correlated this with educational outcomes and found somewhat inconsistent results, as of course has been found also by the large studies that Susie mentioned in the beginning, the OECD PISA trials and the ACES ISIL trials, and more recently the NAP RCT. So, the question comes, however, when I looked at this data and I looked at all the other studies, most of which use questionnaires, why are we still using questionnaires to assess computer usage when every student has a perfectly good computer sitting right in front of him, able to report everything that the student does on the computer for us? I mean, after all, Google and Amazon and every other company is doing this. Why are not educators collecting this data? Well, I found out, because it's not easy. The sort of questions, of course, that we need to ask, and I don't think we really know, is, well, for the students who use computers, how much computer use actually is happening in schools? How much in different, what type of computer use, what kind of resources, how does that differ between subjects? How much engagement is there on? Is distraction really a problem, the on-off task? And how much are they exploring versus just following what resources have been given to them? What about participation in the variety of ICT skills? Are they using the different resources that they need to acquire all the skills? Distractibility, task switching. How much task switching between on and off task? Because that's a very expensive on focus. And then, of course, digital literacy skills. What sort of Bloom taxonomy levels? And when you get all these parameters, well, which one of these lead to better educational outcomes? Because that's what we really need to know. How much computer use is good use? And if you look at the PISA trials from 2014, in fact, there is a tailing off that the more computers you use, the worse the educational outcomes, which is quite counterintuitive. So the past 3 years, I and eight engineers have been working on delivering a practical, real-time learning analytics system into classrooms so that teachers can see these parameters in their classroom and get the feedback from their instruction. So unfortunately in schools, unlike universities, we don't have a prevailing LMS for us to data mine the back end of. So we had to put agents onto each laptop, which is a task not trivial. We then get the agent to report all the activities, meaning both applications and URLs, to our cloud database. We have an AI engine, which then categorizes instantly whether this is an educational or a non-educational activity, with an accuracy of about 93%. And then we contextualize it using the lesson data to being either on task, off task, or self-discovered task. And we color code those for the teacher, green, red, and blue. We then perform learning analytics on that, on the accumulated data, presented this in real time to the teacher in the form of a color-coded map of the classroom and the engagement of the students, whether they're on task or off task. We also have teacher class reports for reflection after the class and teacher notification of outliers. We also present the data to the student. We did a small study, a subgroup of students, where we presented the data in a console that the students had, and I'll tell you the results of that later. We also, of course, collect large data sets, and the learning analytics we use to write reports, which we can present to educators. And we also have a module coming out which allows parents to manage and supervise homework. So how do we inform the teachers? Well, the most important thing that I figure is that that face-to-face teaching is most important. So any analytics or any data we present to the teachers has to be glanceable and not take their time away from personal teaching. And so we present a dashboard to the teacher, which presents all the students and a simple color-coded or traffic light-coded indication of whether the student's on task in green, off task in red, exploring their own educational task in blue or orange where it's uncertain. Also, there is a history bar for the lesson so that the teacher can only glance at it a few times, and if there is an issue, can check on the history bar to see whether the student actually has had a problem for throughout the lesson or whether it's just instantaneous. So if you see a screen like that, you've probably lost the class. And we see these not uncommonly with substitute teachers, which is one of those interesting factoids. And so the teacher also gets like one of those debate worms that you see on television for their lesson, the attention span of the kids and how many are on task and how many are off task, so that they can compare that to their lesson plan and see how successful it has been. We also give the teacher grouped data, and we borrowed this from Amazon, of course, from Google Analytics. And we every 5 minutes, we show the teacher the groups of students and what they're doing and how they're moving between different tasks on their computers, which again is a reflection of how well their lesson plan is flowing. And so that gives the teacher a real-time vision of what students are doing the what the 25 students are doing on their computers whenever they want to see that. After the lesson, the teacher typically has only a few seconds to reflect on the lesson, and so we present them with reports, but they can look at only the ones that they're interested in. The student activity focus, how distracted they were. The student resource management, in other words, what resources they used. What kind of diversity of usage categories they have, how rich their experience was, and also internet search data analysis. Now, I haven't got time in this talk to cover all of those, but I'll give a terrible slide which kind of montages it all together, and and I won't go through it all. But so the first one shows you all the students and how they and their respective engagement, with the red being under the line being disengaged. And here we have distractibility, and we define a distractibility index from the time off task weighted by the number of task switches. So for the same time off task, if you have task switched into it many times, then your distractibility is higher because there's good data to show that reduces concentration. We also show the resources used. So if you gave them a bunch of resources, well, did they actually use them? Did they find other resources which may be better than yours, and therefore you can use those for your next lesson? Were they off task? And if they were off task, what kind of off task things were there? If you were on Melbourne Cup day, you'd probably find that they were all on Melbourne Cup. And then the uncertain ones. I'll talk more about these generic activities. This is a distribution of the different types of activities later. And finally, we also look at the search engine parameters that they use. So we collect this data, and then we do we can present some picture of what's happening in Australian classrooms on the students' computers. So this data set is from four schools, consisting of 549. So it doesn't quite represent Australia. There are also four independent schools. And they're also from year 7 to 12, which is the best, probably the best age group to study. And it included 21,000 lessons and more than 750 activities, 1,000 activities, and it spanned almost one year. So the first kind of descriptive, very trivial descriptive numbers are the average computer use, which is about 20 minutes in 50-minute, 45 to 50-minute lessons, and with a fairly narrow distribution. And the total off-task time is about 17 minutes. I mean, this group data, of course, demolishes almost all usable information. So you can slice this according to subject, according to year level, according to teacher, according to learning approach. So the next thing that you might ask, well, what are all the on-task activities as a grouped parameter? So not surprisingly, Microsoft Word is, again, just like Simon Cook found, by far the greatest. Email, Google, the learning management system for that particular school, and then PowerPoint and a whole bunch of others. The off-task activities are by far YouTube. And we find that 95% of YouTube use in classrooms is off-task. If a teacher uses YouTube, typically they will put it up on the screen for everybody to see and not on private viewing on the computer. Then there is Netflix, which is quite nice. I enjoy that too. Spotify, iTunes, Dolphin, and there's a cool one, coolmaths.games, which is actually a gaming site camouflaged as a maths lesson. That had us fooled for quite a few weeks. Search engine use, well, this is the percentage of students who have used anything other than Google, and it's very few. So there are many students, majority of students have never searched on anything other than Google. Wolfram Alpha is nowhere to be seen there. And in terms of the advanced use of search engines, only 2.9% of students in our cohort actually used any advanced search tools such as Boolean or any kind of filters. So how long do students actually spend on any one task? By far the majority of the time is spent on activities that are less than 2 minutes, and then with a tailing off. So the nature of work on computers in classrooms is very short periods of attention and swapping between tasks. The distractibility index, very steady in year 7 to 10, and then when they get to 11 and 12, when HSC comes, self-governance kicks in, and distractibility takes a huge dive, which is interesting. So I was telling you about the categories of learning. So we can divide the activities into a number of Bloom kind of and 21st century skill type categories, creating, co-working, processing, e-content, researching, and so on. Into broad categories and then finer categories there. And we can compare, for example, two schools which had traditional teaching and two schools which had student-directed teaching. And let's see what kind of computer activities and what kind of skills these students are acquiring. Well, the traditional teaching, MS Word, Google Docs, and their LMS. And all the Google searches, only 1.5 actually use any advanced any tools. For the self-directed, research-based activities, free internet searching, as you'd expect, education perfect, of course MS Word as well, but more email for communication between the students, PowerPoint for presentation, very little Google Docs, and actually CAD, or computer-aided design, actually makes its appearance here. And so it is very useful, Google Search is 19% knew how to use advanced Google Search tools. So there's certainly a very different skill set between these two schools, which we can now actually clearly see. Now, whether this translates into better educational outcomes, we don't know yet, but of course, that's the next step. We can also code those activities to Bloom digital taxonomy. Not very well, but it's our first effort. And you can build a Bloom taxonomy kind of tree, and you can see that for that cohort of students, most of it is, of course, in the remembering, and there's quite a bit of the top level. And if you look at the highest Bloom students and the lowest Bloom students, there's a huge difference between the creative work of those in the high group and the remembering work in the lower group. When you look at the Bloom taxonomy across different subjects, technology, mathematics, and science, there's quite a bit of variability, and individual columns actually are different teachers. But when you then look at the averages between the subjects, then the Bloom levels are not that different. Art actually has the highest Bloom level, for what it's worth, with the others being similar. When you look at the individual teachers ignoring the subjects, the most of the variability probably comes from the different teachers. We have to do regression, multiple regression analysis to actually tease out what the what factors affect the bloom level most. After, of course, we validate the bloom scale, because at the moment it's unvalidated yet. And as I mentioned in the beginning, we tried a small test. We gave 153 students access to their own console, showing them their own engagement, a form of direct feedback to the students. We had an 8-week baseline and an 8-week treatment, or sorry, the, you know, treat, whatever you call it, 8-week period when they had feedback. And what we found was that they had about a 33% off-task time at the beginning, this group, and once the feedback was given to them, there was a spontaneous, self-directed reduction in their off-task. Now, 8 weeks, you would think that there would be a diminution of that effect, because initially they'd be enthusiastic and so on. But I haven't got the data here, but the effect was unchanged for 8 weeks, which was quite surprising to me. I didn't expect it at all. So how would you implement a system like that in your school? First of all, the teacher does nothing, has to do nothing. Thank you. We install the system and with the IT department. The school has to give us their student data, the timetable of our Adval or timetabler. No CSV. It's an absolute nightmare to try to do this through CSV. We deploy the agents via an image or an AD group policy automatically, and we auto-register, so the students don't have to register and teachers don't have to register. We then set up the automated Adval through the LIS interface so that you have automatic rollover during terms, because you don't want to have to be doing this over and over. And we also give the school an admin console so they can maintain it. If a student changes class or whatever, or a teacher leaves or whatever, they can do that themselves. And then, of course, we have to train the teachers, which Mary does for us, and train the educators on how to best use this. What are some of the challenges? Well, implementation is not easy. Australian independent schools have a very messy IT setup. Interoperability is a serious issue, and we have spent a lot of time and burnt a number of schools in trying to get together the AD and all their other IT networks. And so at the moment we've captured, we've reported, and we've got some we've got teachers to actually use this. The next task is to actually look at the educational outcomes, correlate our parameters with those outcomes, and then predict and then refine our algorithms to actually use this to improve educational outcomes. And therefore, validation is a big issue. Data privacy, ownership, and security has not really been a problem at this stage. I'd like to thank Jane Hunter, who has been really helpful in getting teacher focus groups and helping us making this real for the schools. Thank you very much. Thank you, Susan.